Thanks for joining us here today. I kind of wonder how many of you saw this program advertised and thought to yourself, how are they going to do that? Norman Rockwell and ballet? Well, what a perfect match was made many, many years ago. And when we opened this building in 1993, we were graced with the presence of the Albany Berkshire Ballet at that point. And they've come back a number of times to do this program here. But it wasn't until Allison approached us and said, what do you think about doing this thing together? What about a collaboration? How we can draw people in, find out a little bit more about Norman Rockwell's work, and then have students see how movement can add to their enjoyment of art. So this evening, what we're going to do is give you a chance to see something that we actually debuted at Jacob's Pillow a few weeks ago. So you'll have an opportunity to see this fantastic performance. I just want to reassure everyone, especially the folks in the back row, I won't be dancing, so that's a big bonus. But what I am going to do is introduce some of the artworks that are going to be performed, brought to life, if you will, on this very stage. And we're going to start out with a painting that you can see in our galleries, but we have a reproduction right over here. It's called The Marriage License. Have any of you seen that picture before? A few of you have. Great. What Norman Rockwell is doing is he's communicating a very simple message here. And the message is, we all do kind of the same thing, right? We all have some similar experiences. Norman Rockwell didn't decide to paint a big cathedral or a fancy park. What he did was he took that common moment and celebrated it. Luckily now everyone has the opportunity to go to get their marriage license, and Mr. Rockwell here is showing us this young couple, very excited by the opportunity. You can see the golden light shining on them and the contrast between the man sitting there, the clerk, as he might have seen one or two people have their marriage license signed, maybe even that day. I often wonder, too, if maybe he's not thinking about the day when he signed his marriage license, though those many years ago. And next time you folks are on Jeopardy, I'm going to give you a little in with Alex Trebek. You'll start talking about this painting, as everyone does on Jeopardy. And you'll say, you know, Alex, that painting was on the cover of the Post June the 11th, 1955. And he'll be impressed, and he'll chit-chat with you afterwards. And if you ever forget that, all you have to do is look right up here in this section of the painting and you'll see that Mr. Rockwell let us know what date that was going to appear on the cover of the Post. So I'm going to let the Albany Berkshire Ballet show you and give you an experience that will be second to none. And you'll find yourself right in this painting. Now that's a tough act to follow right there. What a beautiful job they did. And as we looked at that image, what we noticed was that Rockwell, again, gave us many, many details to look at. And we saw that Albany Berkshire Ballet brought all those small details. The hat in his hand, the pen that she signed the document with. All of these things help us feel like we're right there. The next image that's going to come to life for us is called Girl at the Mirror. Some of you might have seen that picture before. And many people read that picture as an opportunity for transition in one's life. I really look at it, a lot of Norman Rockwell's artwork that way, giving us a chance to see change in our own lives. We may not see this moment on the front of the Berkshire Eagle, but we'll definitely remember this in our diaries. And tonight, what you'll see is this young girl as the thought process carries forward, and we find out what she thinks about herself. Enjoy the next program. as we see that Rockwell does give us that opportunity, whether we're a young boy or girl, doesn't make any difference, to really explore those ideas of change in our lives. That was one of the first images that appeared on the cover of the magazine after Rockwell had moved here to Stockbridge. We're going to turn the clock back, though, to 1937. What was going on in 1937? Now, remember, I'm an education curator, so I'm going to expect people raising their hands. Well, you don't have to raise your hands. So we're right in the middle of the Great Depression, of course, and life was changing in many, many different ways for many, many different careers. And the idea of a vaudeville dance team might have started to seem a little stale. So Norman Rockwell gave us a chance to take a peek into that world, what that transition was like for a couple of dancers that you'll see performing, Dolores and Eddie, the Gaiety dance team.
In the winter, in the summer, don't we have fun? Times are bum and getting bummer, still we have fun. There's nothing surer, the rich get rich and the poor get children. In the meantime, in between time, ain't we got fun? Lord's mad and getting
Thank you very much. And that really brings you through that time period so wonderfully. We have that opportunity to see their career arc and then peak and then slightly drop off there at the very end. And Rockwell does give us that opportunity to use our own imagination as we look at these images, whether it's one of the four that we're doing here tonight or one of the many that we have in our galleries or one of the many that are across the country or around the world. We're going to finish up tonight with an image that hopefully all of you are very familiar with. If you aren't, you will be after this performance. This is Rosie the Riveter, a very exciting image that gave us an opportunity to remember part of American history that could have very easily been lost. As all of you might remember from your history books, as I look across the audience, probably none of you old enough to have had this experience firsthand, right? Okay. You're welcome. So women were a very important part of the World War II effort, and I was fortunate enough a number of years ago to interview a number of women who were Rosie the Riveters, if you will. And I had a series of questions I asked them, you know, how did you get involved, where did you go to school? I was surprised to find out that many of these women went to Mount Holyoke or went to Smith, went to some pretty well-known schools, and didn't end up having an opportunity to work, of course. But when this chance came up, and bless you, when I use that term chance very, very loosely, they took it. It was responsibility these women felt, and almost every woman that I spoke with, she said, I felt it was my duty to do that. I had children at home, I had parents to care for, my husband or boyfriend was overseas fighting, and this was a way that the government encouraged me to help, was to get into a factory, work at a dangerous job that I'd been trained for about 2 weeks sometimes. So this one of the last interviews I did was a woman from New York City. She still lived in the same apartment she was living in when she was a war worker. And I said to her, at the end, I asked every one of them, what was your most memorable moment? And a lot of the women spoke very frankly about having their own money, being able to walk into a bar to buy a drink and not be looked at as kind of a questionable person. Maybe the opportunity to have some free time if they could ever find it. And this one lady, she said to me, when I asked that very question, she said, well, I have to tell you the most memorable experience that I had during this time period. She was a munitions tester, and I had to ask her what that meant because I didn't know. She tested the ammunition and all the other exploding type things. She might not have said exploding type things. And I thought to myself, I'm going to get a great answer here. She's going to say, the third day I was on the job, I blew the whole factory up. Right? But her answer was a great one. The answer was the taste of the orange juice that she would receive at the Red Cross when she would donate blood on her lunch hour. So with that long introduction, we'll leave you with Rosie the Riveter.
Absolutely, guys.